Hello, I'm Alex Davies, founder of Wealth Club, and today I'm with Oliver Bedford of Hargreave Hale to talk about Hargreave Hale's AIM VCT. Hello, Oliver. For those who aren't familiar with the Hargreave Hale VCT, can you tell me a bit about that and also tell me about your own experience?
Sure. So we launched the Hargreave Hale AIM VCT in 2004. We have grown that over the years through multiple fundraisings and also through a merger with our other VCT, the Hargreave Hale AIM VCT 2. That merger took place in 2018 and was a catalyst for an opportunity for us to review our policies, processes, controls, expand our team, and prepare ourselves for future growth. I joined Hargreave Hale in 2004, following a 9-year career in the army, initially as an investment analyst, and then I was appointed to co-manager in 2012, and then took over as lead manager in 2019. I mean, as the name suggests, the VCT invests predominantly in companies listed on AIM, but we also have an element of our portfolio invested into private companies.
So Oliver, can you just explain the key differences between an AIM VCT and a generalist approach?
So I think it's important to acknowledge that, you know, both styles have their pros and their cons. In the case of an AIM VCT, clearly we're predominantly invested in public companies, which means we've probably got more portfolio diversification and more liquidity. So for example, we have about 100 equity investments, 70 of them are qualifying and roughly 30 are non-qualifying. That also means that through liquidity, we estimate that making use of the market, if need be, that we could convert about 40% of our NAV into cash in five business days, taking into account certain assumptions about the market. I mean, investing in public companies also means that the share prices of the underlying portfolio companies are perhaps more transparent. They're set by third parties, they're independent, and they are constantly being updated in real time to reflect, latest news about the companies or the sector or the wider market, which gives us greatest confidence in the NAV, the print being accurate, and allows us also to update our NAV on a weekly basis. I mean, being invested in public companies means that our portfolio companies are more exposed to share price volatility. It's a feature of every listed company, but clearly more pronounced for small companies, and most obviously those on AIM. But, we have a well-diversified portfolio, and even if underlying companies can have quite pronounced movements higher or lower, it's the net effect of that that matters, and they can sometimes offset one another. And the metric we look at to measure this is the volatility of our net asset value rather than the share price. And when we look at that over 5 years, our underlying volatility is broadly the same as the FTSE 100 and lower than AIM. Being in public companies also allows us to reduce our investments or sell them if we want to, either because the thesis is not developing as we expected, or because the company is doing well and it's growing in value. The ability to partially dispose of an investment allows us to control stock-specific risk and to recycle capital for investment into new opportunities or to fund other expenses if we need to. That also means that we can hold investments for the long term. And if you look at the portfolio at the moment, we have five investments that have got a unrealized gain of more than 1,000%. Four of those have been held for more than 10 years, which speaks to the point about the power of long-term compounding. Being able to invest for the long term means also that we're able to build portfolio maturity. And you can see that through the average market cap of our companies, which is now £341 million. And it's supported by revenues of £73 million on average. So yes, of course, we're a venture capital fund, and of course, we're investing into small companies, but it needs to be seen in context of the overall portfolio.
Obviously, AIM has had a phenomenal year. Is it sustainable?
AIM is a large market. There is over 700 companies, and they vary in size from a few millions up to several billions. It's a home to innovators, people creating new products, new services. And there's no doubt that some of those were strong themes last year. But I think equally that the events of last year, they didn't change the direction of travel. They might have accelerated some of the trends, but I don't think that as a result of it, that people's thirst for innovation or for progress has changed at all.
And talk to me about the types of companies you're looking to invest in.
So, there are many different qualities in a good company. They can have strong management teams, or you'd want them to have strong management teams, good balance sheets, intellectual property, pricing power, revenue visibility, there are many different qualities. I think it's important to note that at the point we invest, these are not fully formed companies, and and there will be gaps. That's why it's important to do proper diligence and research. At the same time, you know, we can, by virtue of the fact that they're public companies, you know, we can sort of reflect that risk through our portfolio sizing. We can take initially small positions into companies where perhaps the technology or the commercial model lacks maturity. And then as that develops and we get more confidence in the management team or the business model, we then have opportunities to layer in more capital. Because inevitably growing companies, they need further funds to invest into people, technology, infrastructure, etc. I think that approach works well too for the companies themselves. It avoids too much early dilution for founders. And it means that with supportive shareholders, they can continue their growth journey, secure that they will be able to attract that additional capital to invest in the business as the opportunity develops.
And there are any sort of companies you avoid?
Now, I think, you know, history has shown it's important to be open-minded to what's in front of you. You know, sometimes, you know, companies which may look extremely attractive on first review may not make good investments, and the opposite's also true. So remain open-minded and then, you know, take the thesis forward and see what develops from there.
And the VCT rules are pretty strict. So are there enough good quality AIM companies that you can actually invest in?
You know, absolutely. Look, it's a large market, and you know, and it covers you know, every sector of the UK economy. You know, last year was a very busy year for us. Potentially, record amounts of capital were deployed, and I think that was because there were sort of various things going on. You had companies who were experiencing perhaps growth which was more rapid than they were anticipating. That required additional investment or, you know, working capital. There were people or companies who saw opportunities to exploit dislocated markets, and again, that might need funding. Or there were good companies who found that obviously their revenue base had been heavily impacted and they needed to strengthen their balance sheet so they could emerge from the crisis in a strong position. So there were lots of different factors, and you know, made for a good environment for deploying capital. I think what's different now to last year, in fact, the last couple of years, is the IPO market had been quite subdued through 2019 and 2020, you know, first as a consequence of Brexit and then the pandemic. And that's decisively changed now. So, you know, we've never been busier reviewing investment opportunities.
And do you want to talk about some of the recent investments you've made?
I mean, talked to two of them. So we just completed a follow-on investment into Kidly. Kidly is an online retailer of clothes and toys for children aged 0 to 5 years. Unusually for a startup or a small company, it's led by an experienced chief executive who previously held a senior role at ASOS. And, you know, he had spotted a sort of gap within the market, which he thought was underserved, and developed, you know, his business, which is selling sort of research-led, family-approved or parent-approved products. You know, he had a phenomenal year last year. The business grew by more than 200%. And accelerated its strategic growth plan by 2 years, and therefore he came back and looked for further capital to support that. Another company is Diurnal. It's a speciality pharmaceutical company developing a portfolio of hormone therapeutics, in this case for endocrine conditions. You know, they again felt that the existing approved drugs were not serving that market particularly well because it's a relatively small market for pharma, and they developed products to address that. The clinical data looked encouraging, and we proceeded with an investment, and we were pleased to see that not long after we'd completed the investment, that the company had its first product approved in the UK and Europe.
And do you want to talk to me about some of the long-held investments, any particular highlights?
I think, you know, Surface Transformers is a really interesting case study. We've been invested in it for 5 years, and we've invested across five different rounds. The company is developing carbon ceramic brake discs for the automotive market. As you might imagine, for a small company out from the Northwest trying to break into a large, well-established, mature market, which is dominated by a single player, it's difficult. And the development process working with OEMs is very lengthy. To help address that, they were deploying their products into the retrofit market, which was giving them not just short-term cash flows, but also sort of technical validation of the performance of their product. Now, last year, you know, they were concerned that you know, the market conditions might mean that they saw a shortfall in revenues. They raised more money to make sure they could continue to invest into those development programs. And then as a result of that, they then announced a £28 million revenue contract for a large US automotive company. And that was, you know, followed also or preceded by large contract with a German OEM, and also awards from Aston Martin and Koenigsegg. So, you know, it's great to see that after a long journey and, you know, success investments, that the company is now going to commercial production later this year and expects to report profits and maiden cash flows next year.
And how's the pandemic been for you and your companies?
Well, I mean, dealing with our team first, because, I mean, it's pretty simple. I mean, like everyone, we transitioned to working from home. It worked remarkably smoothly. The only thing we had to change was to maintain more regular contact with our portfolio companies. Obviously, the situation was highly fluid, and companies were updating regularly about the market as they saw it developing. I think for the private companies too, we were, you know, reviewing valuations, at least informally, on a monthly basis rather than on a quarterly basis, just to make sure that the valuations correctly reflected the very latest developments. For the companies themselves, I think there were sort of three different things going on. There's obviously a large number of companies that weren't necessarily affected by the pandemic beyond their sort of working arrangements. And then you had companies, you know, like sort of Gousto or Kidley, where they saw, you know, high levels of demand, and that creates its own stresses on management teams. You know, do you have the operation and the infrastructure and the working capital and resource to respond to that? And, you know, it can be challenging in a different way to people who'd had revenues lost or heavily curtailed. But even that was interesting, because companies like Escape Hunt, which operates escape rooms, or Tortilla, which was a burrito restaurant, you know, they suffered heavily in the case of escape rooms. Obviously, they weren't particularly popular during lockdown, but they saw an opportunity to develop a digital product. And then also to capitalize on attractive commercial terms being put to them by landlords. So they raised money and they accelerated their rollout. Seems an odd thing to do during a lockdown, but actually it shows that if you can combine bold leadership with strong execution and supportive shareholders, and actually you can turn adversity into an opportunity. And they will exit. They are exiting lockdown now in a stronger position than before they went into it, which is obviously very pleasing to see. For Tortilla, you know, they operated over 40 restaurants across the country, all closed down during lockdown, but they were able to recoup, you know, the vast majority of their revenues through their online sales. They were already established on delivery, and clearly that was extremely strong for them. So again, you know, through good trading online and also support from the government through the different schemes, they've come out of last year in remarkably strong shape.
And are there any recent exits you can talk about?
We're constantly adjusting our portfolio. So in the 6 months to 31st of March, we had 7 partial disposals and 5 complete exits. I mean, the average return on that was 118% over book cost. There's no doubt that the highlight was the sale of Oxgenetics, or Oxgene, to WuXi AppTec for 180% return over just under 2 years.
As a poll, how's the VCT performed?
I mean, we went into 2020 feeling quite positive. The UK just returned a pro-enterprise government, Brexit, there was some clarity. We felt good about the outlook for small companies. Clearly, things took a radically different path to the one we had imagined. But, you know, for reasons we've touched upon, you know, some of the themes that were exposed to within the portfolio, we had a very strong turnaround in the sort of latter part of 2020. And, you know, we're very pleased to return plus 25% over the year. That strength has carried on into early 2021, and we've returned another 19.5% over the 5 months to 31st of March. I think also too, a combination of NAV returns and also fundraising activities meant that our fund has grown by just over 100 million in assets. And that's allowed us to invest back into people. So we've added resource, we brought in new skills and experience to the team, which I hope all will benefit our shareholders in future years.
So finally, if I want to put money into a VCT this year, why should I consider yours?
So I think over the last 5 years, we've successfully scaled the VCT. We've developed a more mature portfolio. We've invested in people. We've strengthened our board. We've reviewed and improved our processes and controls. And we've returned 83% total return to shareholders, which equates to an internal rate of return of 19% per year over 5 years, net of the income tax relief. I mean, I think, you know, when we look forward here, the UK economy looks well positioned for some strong growth, and we feel we have a portfolio and a team that's well positioned to exploit that.
Oliver Bedford of Hargreave Hale AIM VCT, thank you very much.
Thank you.